Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. My name is Michael Reever. I'm the Vice President of Government Relations at the Chicagoland Chamber of Commerce. Welcome to the thematic session on Hong Kong, the gateway for Chinese outbound investment, jointly organized by the Hong Kong Trade Development Council and the Department of Commerce of Guangdong Province. This afternoon, industry experts from Hong Kong will tell you why and how you should use the Hong Kong services platform to nurture Sino-American investment partnerships. First of all, I just want to remind everyone that with your devices, for those of you using the interpretation headsets, please note that channel C is for English, and channel A is for Mandarin Chinese. Channel A is for Mandarin Chinese. First of all, may I invite Ms. Xu, Commercial Counselor, Consulate General of the People's Republic of China in Chicago, to deliver the opening remarks. Ms. Xu?
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's my great pleasure to join you this afternoon. On behalf of the Chinese Consulate in Chicago, I would like to welcome our delegates from Hong Kong and also from Guangdong area. I also would like to thank all the local communities, business communities to join us today. I think this is a very good opportunity for you to meet, to exchange information, and also promote mutual understanding and explore potential cooperation. This is my second time to join you the co-event by Hong Kong and the mainland China, which demonstrates the co-efforts by these two parties and also the great efforts and great importance they have attached in developing business relations with the Middle East and also Middle West and also United States. Thanks to their joint efforts by business communities and also the governments, the bilateral trade and economic cooperation between China and the United States maintains a very steady growth despite the difficulties and also challenges in the world economy. So last year, our two-way trade reached $55 billion, and also our FDI in stock reached $114 billion. So Middle West plays a very important role in this bilateral cooperation, and we are the number one trading partners for the Chicago Customs District, and also many companies based in Chicago area, especially those Fortune 500 companies, they have invested in China, and also they are expanding in China. I think they have already got very good returns. And also at the same time, Chinese companies is taking off, and we do see that the growing momentum of Chinese companies making investment in the Middle West, and we know there are more than 50 companies in this Chicago area. Actually, in the Middle West area, we have more than 160 companies with total investment more than $11 billion. So the two biggest and also two latest investment, maybe as you know, one is Lenovo. They acquired Motorola Mobility last year, this year by $2.9 billion, and the other one is Wanda Group. They are going to build the third largest, the tallest skyscraper in Chicago area. So we have many companies coming over, and a lot of them actually focus in the manufacturing sector because they are good suppliers to the three giant auto companies. I do see that this momentum will continue because I believe that the Chinese government will continue to encourage Chinese companies to go global. And also, we do believe that the Chinese company, Chinese economy, will enjoy a continuous development by adjusting our economy structure and the opening, continue to reform the opening to outside world. So the two initiatives, like Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank and also One Belt, One Road, this is they are two most recent ambitious program by Chinese government to promote its economic growth and also by pursuing common prosperity with other countries. So I think Guangdong and Hong Kong can play a very important role in the process, because Guangdong is the orange of the Marine Silk Road, and also is the pioneer in Chinese opening up 30 years ago. So Guangdong has already become number one economy in China, and also the biggest exporter, biggest import, and also large FDI utilization. And now it's become also a manufacturing base. At the current, I think they are also embracing another round of opening up by establishment of the pilot foreign trade zone in Guangdong province. I think Guangdong will become more transparent and also more favorable in its business environment. And Hong Kong, as a traditional international financial center and also a very important business, trade, and a service hub for Chinese opening up, it has been playing a very important role in Chinese opening up and the foreign corporations. As I remember this morning, many speakers mentioned that Hong Kong has been a gateway or window for Chinese opening up. I do agree, and also this is a very important platform for Chinese opening up and developing overseas cooperation. And I think this advantage will continue in the coming years. So I think both governments from the United States and also from China attach great importance to our further expansion of business cooperation. As a commercial counselor here, the local governments from Chicago, also from state level, they do welcome Chinese investment here. And also our government in the province level and also from the central government also welcome foreign companies to expand an investment in China. So both governments are working very closely together to create a more favorable environment for business. So as you know, China and the United States are conducting the bilateral investment treaty for 20 rounds. So I think they are already entering a stage of a substantive negotiation. Hopefully, at the end of this year, we have some very good news. And also this month, actually, we have two very big important delegations coming over to the United States. Two of them are led by two vice premiers. One is Vice Premier Wang Yang. One is for Vice Premier Liu Yandong. They are for the dialogue, like SEND, for the seventh round of SEND. And Vice Premier Liu is for the people-to-people exchange and consultation. And also in the coming September, our President Xi will visit the United States. He will make a state visit to the United States at the invitation of President Obama. So this high-level contact and negotiations, I think they create and also provide very critical guidelines for establishing our bilateral relationship. As you know, we two governments has agreed to build a new type of major country relationship that is no conflict, no confrontation, mutual respect, and win-win cooperation. So I think that's very important, and also provides a stable environment for the business circles. So I think the economic cooperation in our bilateral way is a cornerstone of this overall international relations. And I think everyone present here today are playing your part in it. And I hope everyone sees the opportunity. As the consulate here, we do encourage Chinese companies to have a cooperation with US companies, either by inviting them to have a cooperation in China, and also by making investments in the United States. So I will make my best to provide my service to everyone who is interested in promoting the relationship. So I hope today's event a very successful one. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Ms. Xu. Next, I'd like to invite Mr. Raymond Yip, Deputy Executive Director of the Hong Kong Trade Development Council, to address us. Mr. Yip.
Thank you, Michael. Ladies and gentlemen, a very good afternoon to everybody once again. And I would also like to thank Commercial Councillor Su for honoring this event with her personal presence to give us very encouraging remarks. I'm very pleased to see such a good turnout for our thematic session, Hong Kong, the Gateway for Chinese Outbound Investment, which shows the keen interest among our US friends, not least from the Midwestern region, towards this exciting new trend. There has always been very close business partnership between Guangdong and Hong Kong. In fact, most of the people in Hong Kong, including my parents, actually came from Guangdong province. And in recent years, this very close partnership has extended to foreign investment partnerships with companies from around the world. And today, the Department of Commerce of Guangdong Province has jointly organized this session with us to show you the tremendous opportunities coming our way. For the past decade, Chinese outward foreign direct investments grew at an annual average rate of 39%. Not only is China's outward FDI now at an all-time high, China has also become the world's third largest investor economy in each of the past years, only after the US and Japan. Under China's 12-5-year plan, Chinese enterprises are encouraged to transform and upgrade, themselves by going out to seek investment opportunities. This was reiterated by the deliberations at the third plenary session of the 18th Central Committee in November 2013 and the National People's Congress this March. As a result, many Chinese enterprises are actively seeking investment opportunities worldwide in a wide array of industries, from natural resources and energy to intangible assets such as advanced technologies, intellectual property, consumer brands, and distribution networks. Naturally, the US is one of our key destinations. By the end of the year 2013, China's cumulative direct investments into the US was close to $22 billion, making it the fourth largest destination of Chinese foreign direct investments. And there is certainly room for further growth. However, in fostering more and more partnerships, both US and Chinese enterprises will face a number of challenges, from the negotiation stages to partnership formation and also post-deal integration. Ladies and gentlemen, that's where Hong Kong comes in. Our independent legal system upholds the rule of law, emphasizing intellectual property protection, as you may have heard this morning in the plenary session. Our low and simple tax system, liberal trade and investment regimes, free flow of information and capital, familiarity with Sino-foreign cooperation, are all important elements conducive to enabling conclusion of investment deals. Hong Kong services professionals have profound experience in providing a wide spectrum of services to support the investment process, including financing, due diligence, feasibility studies, risk assessments, intellectual property protection, valuation services, and post-transaction management. So in short, we know the language and the culture. We have the context and the connections. We help mitigate risk from both the buy side and the sell side, and we smoothen the whole process. But ladies and gentlemen, don't just take it from me. According to the Chinese Ministry of Commerce, the mainland's cumulative direct outward investment of over $660 billion as at the end of 2015, of that amount, close to 60%, 60, were directed to or channeled through our city of Hong Kong, proving that our city plays a pivotal role in facilitating cross-border investment partnerships. And by the way, Hong Kong has always been and still is the largest investor on the Chinese mainland. Therefore, we at the Hong Kong Trade Development Council has taken up the role of facilitating more of these win-win-win connections for you, for the Chinese corporate investors, and for the Hong Kong services professionals. Some of them are present today. Over the past 5 years, we've arranged 8 outward investment missions in collaboration with the Chinese Ministry of Commerce and various provinces, including our long-standing partner, Guangdong Province, bringing Chinese enterprises to North America, Europe, and Japan. Today, we and the Department of Commerce of Guangdong Province are delighted to have brought over a delegation of investors from Guangdong Province with us, nearly 30 of them. They are here to explore partnership opportunities with U.S. manufacturing and environmental technologies. In this connection, Chicago and the state of Illinois alone accounted for close to 1/7 of the machinery manufacturing of this country. I'm certain that we have brought the investors to the right place at the right time today. You will soon hear more from Hong Kong's accounting and legal experts on how to take advantages of our platform to enter partnership with Chinese enterprises. Most of these Hong Kong services professionals are here today, and they're ready to help you to tap into the exciting business opportunities arising from this going out policy of Chinese enterprises. You will hear more shortly from also the accounting and legal professionals on how to take advantage of the Hong Kong platform. So ladies and gentlemen, I hope that through this exchange, we will deepen your understanding about the requirements of Chinese investors, and also you'll be able to forge some interesting deals with them. I always would like to liken trade and investments to dating and marriage. Trading is more like dating. Investment is more marriage. So let's have some dating today, and hopefully some marriages will come later on. But if you want to get married instantly, by all means do that. Let us help you to be your matchmaker. So once again, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Yip. Now I'd like to invite Mr. Hen, Deputy Director, Department of Commerce of Guangdong Province, to address us. Mr. Hen.
Respected Mrs. Xu Luomei, Commerce Counselor at the Consul General of PRC in Chicago, respected Mr. Craig Miller, CEO of Association of Corporate Growth, respected Mr. Raymond Yip, Deputy Executive Director of HKTDC, all the guests, ladies and gentlemen, Good afternoon. I am very glad to arrive from City of Flowers, Guangzhou, to City in a Garden, Chicago. On behalf of Guangdong Provincial Department of Commerce, I would like to extend my warm welcome to all the guests attending this Guangdong-Hong Kong-U.S. Economic and Trade Exchange Conference. I would also like to thank all the friends who have long supported the economic and social developments in Guangdong. The main purpose of Guangdong and Hong Kong jointly hosting this event is to deepen our understanding on the U.S. investment policies and collaborative opportunities in advanced manufacturing and modern service industries, and also to help friends in the U.S. to get to know Guangdong better so as to promote more future bilateral win-win collaborations at higher levels and in wider areas. We hope that through this carefully planned out conference, we could construct a great platform for entrepreneurs to communicate face-to-face and build up a strong foundation for close collaborations and exchanges in the future. As we all know, the province of Guangdong locates in the southernmost area of mainland China, close to Hong Kong and Macau. With approximately 180,000 square kilometers in area and a residential population of 107 million, it is the largest province in China population-wise. Guangdong is also the first in China that carried out the reform and opening up policy. It is also China's number one province in terms of economic output and foreign trade volume. Its GDP has remained number one in the country for 26 years. In 2014, Guangdong's GDP reached $1.1 trillion, accounting for one-tenth of the national figure. The fiscal income generated in Guangdong reached $310 billion, accounting for approximately one-eighth of the national figure. The foreign trade volume reached $1.08 trillion, accounting for one-fourth of the national figure. The average GDP per capita for the first time in history exceeded $10,000, reaching the income level of middle or upper class countries and regions. The whole province shows a strong economic strength and area competitiveness. Guangdong is also one of the most economically active and open provinces in China, with a strong bilateral investments. It has a huge need for investment and a wide market space. The constantly improving investment environment, government services, and ecological environment bring new opportunities and prospects to investors. The province has long remained as the investment hotbed for entrepreneurs from all over the country and the regions. As of the end of 2014, Guangdong has approved over 170,000 foreign investment projects, with the contract amount reaching $543 billion, and actual use of foreign investments reaching $350 billion. In the meantime, local businesses also developed quickly in this historic opening up era. Their intention of going out is clear and strong as ever in this globalization time. According to our statistics, as of the end of 2014, Guangdong has approved in over 130 countries about 6,888 businesses setting up their overseas operations, with the Chinese investment amount reaching $36 billion on contracts and $43 billion in operations. Many businesses in Guangdong deepened their collaborations with overseas governments and business partners, realizing a win-win collaboration that includes not only the economic benefits for themselves, but also the public environment benefits in these countries. U.S. is the number one economy in the world with a strong economic foundation and also one of the most important economic and trade partners to Guangdong. In 2014, the import-export between Guangdong and the U.S. reached $121 billion, a 2.5% increase over last year, accounting for one-fourth of the U.S.-China trade volume for the same period. As of the end of 2014, there are 4,740 Guangdong-invested projects in the U.S., with total contract amount of $11.4 billion and actual use of $80 billion. The investments of Guangdong has been growing. There are 413 businesses here in the United States that were invested and established by Guangdong, with a total investment of $1.5 billion. In last year alone, Guangdong invested and established 105 businesses in the U.S., an 81% increase over the previous year. The total Chinese investment amount increased by almost 6 times, with the actual investment amount increased by 11.6 times. At the present time, Chinese economy is in the new norm, transitioning from high-speed growth to high and medium-speed growth. Guangdong is also in the key stage of transformational growth, trying hard to implement developmental strategies that are driven by innovation, as well as push for industry transformation and upgrade so as to build up a structure for a modernized industrial system. Responding to the national plan, Guangdong actively participates in building the Silk Road Economic Belt and also the 21st century maritime Silk Road. We also strive to strengthen the economic and trade collaborations with the Western countries, develop the advanced machinery manufacturing industrial belt on the West Bank of Pearl River, and they implement a more active and more diligent open up policy. To build up a good investment environment, Guangdong further relaxes foreign investment entry threshold, pushing industries like financial services, education, culture, healthcare to open up even more to the world. We also carried out administrative review and approval system reform, reducing greatly items that require government approvals and optimizing the remaining approval procedures. These are all to create a business environment that is international and with the rule of law. And in this new environment, we see transparent government services, highly efficient government approval process, and a faster turnaround of business practices. One piece of news worth mentioning here is, as one important undertaking to deepen the reform and widen the opening up in a new area, the much talk about the China-Guangdong Free Trade Trial Zone has begun its construction at the start of the year. And we have much space to work on to increase the collaboration with Western countries. Hong Kong is the worldwide center for financial services and the sea freight transportation, and also the platform for Guangdong businesses investing overseas. It has served in a key bridging role in facilitating Guangdong businesses going out and participate in global cooperation. Undoubtedly, it is important to have Hong Kong's modern service industry join forces with Guangdong manufacturing industry to increase Guangdong businesses' global competitiveness and expand Hong Kong's business realm. Today, by working with Hong Kong to organize this economic and trade delegation, we are extending and perfecting our collaboration and looking to jointly cultivate investment opportunities in the U.S. Sitting here with us today are many well-established Guangdong enterprises in industries including machinery and equipment manufacturing, new materials development, construction materials, furniture and services, etc. They hope to strengthen the investment collaboration with the U.S. through investment, M&A, technology, collaboration, etc. I would hope that entrepreneurs today would take this opportunity to understand more about the investment opportunities before Guangdong and the U.S., understand the related policies, and look for suitable ways to collaborate. We hope the American business will understand more about our business environment. And we sincerely hope that the businesses from Hong Kong today can learn more about the U.S. business environment. The Department of Commerce of Guangdong Province is the main government entity that is charged with promoting Guangdong's foreign economic and trade collaboration. We're willing to form a platform to promote mutual collaboration and provide excellent service. We hope we can work with counterparts and the businesses here in the United States to learn from each other, to jointly further promote our collaboration and increase our level of collaboration in the future, and push for higher levels of collaboration in many areas. At the end, wish a huge success to today's conference. Wish everybody here health and happiness. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hen. Now we're going to explore how Hong Kong is your ideal gateway to establishing partnerships with Chinese enterprises and capital. I'd like to invite Mr. Dennis Brock, Council Member of the Law Society of Hong Kong, to share his views. Mr. Brock.
I'm going to speak today very briefly about the types of structures you might engage with in terms of Chinese entities and why Hong Kong in particular is the place through which those entities should conduct outbound business, why Hong Kong is your ideal center in Asia. Unfortunately, this isn't catching up. SOEs, you'll hear that expression a few times, state-owned enterprises. They are the jewel in the crown in terms of many forms of Chinese enterprise. They're backed by their government or state or provincial governments, and they are probably the most ambitious of the Chinese entities to go overseas investing. You'll also come across private enterprises, i.e. non-state enterprises, which are privately funded by mainland individuals, mainland groups, and they may or may not be listed. There are then consortiums of Chinese entities, joint ventures with or without foreign investment. I really ought to put my glasses on. There are then, is it possible to get the laptop to track the slides? Great, thank you. So when you're looking at the Chinese party who's engaging in outbound investment, what are the factors you might consider? Do they already have outbound investments? Are they familiar with operating overseas? In which industry are they engaging? Is that an industry in which they have any experience overseas again? Do they have international operations? And are they familiar with their own regulations in terms of exporting their capital offshore? Still not working. Why is Hong Kong the ideal place? This is the sell for Hong Kong. Well, there's a number of factors there, and you'll be relieved to hear that I'm not going to go through each of them. I'm only going to deal with principally the legal function, the issue of low tax regime Chris is going to address soon, now just touching on one aspect, which is that it's often said, or has been said of late, that is Hong Kong becoming too much China, becoming too China? Is there any distinction between Hong Kong and mainland China? Some of that has been focused on the events of the end of last year in terms of Occupy Central, which attracted a high degree of international press and was said to be a function of potentially mainland involvement in Hong Kong politics. I think in many ways one might say that the existence of the Occupy Central movement evidences quite the reverse, because if it weren't for the fact that Hong Kong was separate and distinct, it would not be possible for there to have been civil disobedience, people occupying streets, making their position well known. So I don't think it's fair to say Hong Kong is becoming too China. Hong Kong remains unique, separate and unique within the one country, two systems doctrine. And what does that mean, one country, two systems? Well, it means we are one country. We are part of the People's Republic of China, whilst maintaining two systems. In the Joint Declaration, which is enshrined in our basic law, we have a high degree of autonomy in internal matters. And that follows through to our legal services. Our judiciary is underpinned by the fact that in our mini-constitution, the basic law, our judges and our judicial, which shall exercise their powers independently and free from any external influence. Indeed, the image on the right of that screen, top right of that screen, is Justice, a statue which is on our old Supreme Court building, and the old Supreme Court building, which will soon house our Court of Final Appeal. And I'll be discussing the Court of Final Appeal in a few minutes. So what is the Hong Kong Court of Final Appeal? It's our ultimate appellate court, and in 1997 replaced appeals going to the Privy Council in London. And it comprises a panel of 18 non-permanent judges. So the pinnacle of our legal system, we have a Court of Final Appeal, always sits with five judges, one or two of which must be drawn from the panel of 18. And that is to ensure that our decisions and our law remains in line with Commonwealth orthodoxy, so that Hong Kong investors can be confident that its local decisions will not be in some way influenced or skewed by national influences. And it's important to understand that within those 18 judges, largely drawn from the Supreme Court in the UK, as well as Australians, New Zealanders, and in theory, Canadians, there are no judges from mainland China. Our two judicial systems are entirely separate. Hong Kong remains a separate and independent legal system. And importantly, Hong Kong has been ranked fourth out of 148 countries for in respect of judicial independence, and that's well ahead of the United States, United Kingdom, and Singapore. Hong Kong judges have no difficulty in reaching decisions adverse to the interests of Hong Kong, the Hong Kong government, and indeed interests of SOE entities. There is no home court advantage for SOEs or the Hong Kong government in Hong Kong. These are a couple of examples of where decisions have been found by our courts in favor of independent individuals. Moving away from the courts, we have a vibrant arbitration center. And it's independent. It's entirely independent, a non-profit organization without any ties to our government. It's governed by a 25-member council that comprises local international members. It's chaired by Teresa Cheng, who is a prominent international arbitrator. And its vice chair is the Lord Peter Goldsmith, who was the former Attorney General of the United Kingdom. And they're supported by an international advisory board, an executive committee, proceedings committee, and various other committees, all of which are staffed by experts from the United Kingdom, France, Australia, Singapore. It's a truly international center. And courts in Hong Kong maintain a very pro-arbitration approach. They've not refused to enforce any awards in the last 4 years. There's no known case in the past 5 years of a PRC court refusing to enforce an award from Hong Kong in the PRC. Hong Kong has a unique standing. There is, as you may know, an international convention which deals with the enforcement of arbitral awards internationally, the New York Convention, which operates between 150 countries. That operates between countries. So as between Hong Kong and mainland China, we have a separate treaty, a memorandum of understanding, which effectively brings the provisions of the New York Convention into operation between Hong Kong and mainland China, but in a way which ensures that Hong Kong awards have a preferred status when it comes to enforcement. And as the statistics are, Hong Kong awards are routinely and regularly enforced in China. And you're free to choose any arbitrator you wish. In fact, you're free to choose any lawyer you wish. Hong Kong's the Legal Practitioners Ordinance, which is the governing statute for who can practice law in Hong Kong, is disabled when it comes to arbitration. Our immigration ordinance, which regulates those who can work in Hong Kong, is not disabled, but it's made flexible so that foreign arbitrators and foreign lawyers can easily work in Hong Kong when conducting arbitrations in Hong Kong. We are an open skies jurisdiction, all of which should give foreign parties engaging with Chinese entities a high degree of confidence that if they have disputes, that Hong Kong is the ideal venue to resolve those disputes. And I'll at that point wrap up. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Brock. I'd like to now invite Mr. Chris Choi, General Manager, Merger and Acquisition Department of Choi and Low CPA Limited, to speak from the perspective of tax considerations. Mr. Chris.
Thank you, everybody. I'm joined a bit similar today. When I came to the, before I come to the United States and then TDC, the staff of TDC asked me to give a presentation and then talking about the tax in Hong Kong. I think, wow, this is really tough topic for me. Why? And then I asked Henry, the young guy, said, stand over there. I said, okay, how long? He said, around 15 minutes. How come? I said, if really I want to talk about the tax in Hong Kong, 2 minutes. Finish. Okay, let me try to finish the tax in Hong Kong in 2 minutes, okay? Okay, but I have 15 minutes, so I have, I got to tell something more than the tax. Okay, a lot of people ask if, okay, you guys joined the event today, and then I think you listen a lot of speech about doing business in Hong Kong, huh? Okay, right? And then, okay, why Hong Kong? I have a report from IMD. It's talking about the world competitors ranking in 2015. Okay, top three, United States, Hong Kong, and Singapore. And Professor Brace, the director, said a journal analysis of the 2015 ranking showed that top countries are going back to the basics. My personal view, I think the basics, there are two minutes. One is because, okay, United States, Hong Kong, and Singapore is stay on the top quite often. Second, back to the basics, technology and efficiency. The yearbook measures how well countries manage all their resources to facilitate long-term value creation. The overall ranking released today reflects more than 300 criteria, such as efficiency of government, efficiency of doing business, infrastructure, and opportunity, of course. Sorry. You can see the table here. United States is the number one, and Hong Kong is number two, and Singapore is the number three. Switzerland is number four. Okay. The first most competitive driver of Hong Kong, as I say, I try to finish in 2 minutes, okay? Okay, the tax rate, 16.5%. No other tax, okay? No VAT, nothing. Is it simple? Yeah, simple. Okay, but there are some very interesting thing in Hong Kong tax policy. Hong Kong adopts a territorial source principle of taxation. Only profit which have a source in Hong Kong and are taxable. profit sourced elsewhere are not subject to the Hong Kong profit tax. Can you imagine that? Okay, the basic principle, matter of fact, the operation tax, and incidental activities, place where decision is made, cross profit from transaction, business present overseas. Okay, that means if you are doing business in Hong Kong, there are some chance you don't need to pay the tax to. Okay, 2 minutes, finish. Of course, as Dennis said, Hong Kong maintains a civil law system. I think business people always think that if you're doing business in somewhere in the world, most concerned the issue is the system, right? So Hong Kong maintains a legal system, a civil law system, and international accounting standard. That means for you, it's very easy to understand the system, right? And at the same time, that's the system you can trust. Of course, the most important thing is the people in Hong Kong. As Mr. Yip said, we can provide full service for a transaction. And of course, at the same time, the ethics in Hong Kong is one of the most important things for the professional people as well. At last, I would like to share my personal experience with all of you. Currently, I'm doing an M&A in Hong Kong, and then provide our M&A advisory service to our Chinese client. If we're talking about merger and acquisition, it's not easy to close a deal. Because the problem is a lot of Western company, they don't like to sell the company to Chinese company because they're concerned the copy. Anyway, so I suggest my client to build up a joint venture partnership quite often. 2 months ago, I just closed a deal. And American company, they provide the technology, and the Chinese company are provide funding. And then they set up a joint venture company in Hong Kong and produce the product in China. That means the JV company, they can enjoy the low cost in China, and the Chinese company, they can upgrade their technology. And they plan go to the public in Hong Kong 3 years later. That means they can finance in Hong Kong as well. This example, I think this is quite practical example for you to think how to work with the Chinese company and how to use the platform of Hong Kong. You can see that there's a system you can trust, and then you can enjoy the low tax. And of course, Hong Kong is a financial center of Asia, so you can finance in Hong Kong as well. Do you heard the name Liu Lun Kong before? Liu Lun Kong, anyone? No? Okay, this is a name created by Time Magazine. This is a cover story, and then what the story talking about is New York, London, Hong Kong. It's a top three financial center in the world, and then they drive the economics in the world as well. Okay, this is my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Choi. Next, I'd like to introduce Mr. Wu, Senior Vice President of China Aviation Industry, General Aircraft Company Limited, to share his firsthand experience of fostering tripartite investment partnerships with American companies via Hong Kong. Mr. Wu?
Thank you, Mr. Craig Miller. Respected Ms. Shu and respected Mr. Yip, ladies and gentlemen, just now we have heard from speakers talking about experience with Hong Kong as the platform for business services. Now I'd like to spend a few minutes to talk about our case as part of the going out strategy of our company, and we can share some of our experiences and the lessons we learned, and hopefully that in the future that many fellow Chinese companies can learn from us and how to go out through Hong Kong. Our company, China Aviation Industry General Aircraft Company, is a state-owned business set up in 2009 and is headquartered in Zhuhai, Guangdong Province. And our company is an independent aircraft company, and we focus on building aircrafts and also provide a whole basket of services in this area, and we strive to build ourselves into a top solution provider in the industry worldwide. We did an analysis to analyze the industries in China and the United States, and these statistics were back in 2014, and it was no different from 4 years ago. And you can see that in the United States, the general aviation GDP accounts for 0.6% of the national GDP. But in China, the similar percentage is only 0.01%. And we're growing to be closer to the United States, but the major difference we can see from these statistics, and the lack here is because of the aircraft engine manufacturing, and that's why we set up the company to close the gap. And 4 years ago, we didn't have a very good general use aviation aircraft, and we didn't have a good solution in China, but we were thinking that to further develop the future growth in the general aviation, we were thinking about different alternatives to achieve our goal quickly. We thought about the international mergers and acquisition, and since then, China has been supporting companies like us to go out. And in our own experience, through different channels, we found our target company for mergers and acquisition. It is a small aircraft company in the United States. In this particular segment market, it's small, but it's very dynamic. But unfortunately, in 2007-2008 financial crisis, the company suffered a great loss, but luckily for us, this provided a good opportunity for us to tap into the market. And I personally participated in the whole mergers and acquisition negotiation process. The whole process started back in 2011 in the month of June. And in February the next year, and in April, we passed the United States Antitrust investigation. And in July, we got approvals from the mutual governments. And in June, we spent the whole year basically and to have the whole deal closed.
In this process, we saw that the Sirius aircraft's historic delivery amount in 2006 and 2007, the delivery amount was more than 700. And that showed that this is a significant amount, even though it's a small company. Also, we saw that in 2011, it dropped to the bottom. And that was when we finished the merger and acquisition. And then we saw from 2012 and 2013, the delivery is becoming to rebound. And now the number is 308. And then looking forward, we are expecting to have a delivery of 312 aircraft each in that year in 2015. And moving forward to 16. Also, when we talk about the staffers amount, it has gone through a lot of turbulence. They had a huge layoff in the aftermath of the financial recession. However, once we get involved, we created more than 300 positions for R&D engineers. This helps create a lot of work job opportunities in the local communities. We also saw that the airline industry has a good deal of the liability insurance. And here you see the stats about the accident rate and death rate. We can see that before the merger and acquisition, the serious amount of accidents is more than the industry standard. But starting from 2013 and 14, the accident rate has been dropping significantly, and also the accident rate is lower than the industry standard, and the reduction rate is 8 times. More than the industry standard. This is because we have conducted a lot of training for the engineers, the pilots, and customers. Every time when the aircraft experiences any difficulty, we need to let the pilots know that they are able to operate the parachute and they can safely eject. Originally, they didn't know how to effectively operate the mechanics of the aircraft, and because of the thorough training, the pilots were able to maneuver the airplane more carefully and more safely. After the M&A, we see that Cirrus has a steady growth of its market share. From this graph, you can see that there are some traditional industry players that are no longer existent, but Cirrus stay. And this is for a single piston and aircraft. Right now, we are number one in market share. This is a very very good result. As far as our financial situation, from this graph, you can see that after the M&A, the financial health of Cirrus has been improving. In 2012, we see some reduction of the financial growth, but that year aside, we have seen a steady growth. Even though we had a small loss in 2012, in 2013, we start to see growth. And in 2014, the number is becoming even better. As for gross margin, before M&A, it was about 20%, but now it's about 40%. So that is a tremendous change for the company. How did we realize those change? After M&A, shareholders and investors put in a lot of effort to understand, to make better decisions. There are certain changes that we have conducted. First, traditionally, serious clients were private clients, retail clients. Once we took over, we saw that there is other unfulfilled market potentials, and we believe that the company is able to fulfill those market demands. 2013 onward, we approached France and U.S. clients. We delivered over 120 aircraft, and so we successfully adjusted our client base, and that helped our financial bottom line. In 2013, the beginning of that year, we promoted, we launched a plan that helped us to increase our the load to carry passengers and the load that the aircraft could carry. So that helped us to gain more market share as well. Third, this is a special mission type of aircraft. We believe that Cirrus products are able to fulfill that market need. Compared to our competitors, we can do better in fulfilling special needs. And we also see the smaller entry-level private jets. We see that there is no competitors in that market right now. We have over 500 purchase orders. We can continue to fulfill those purchase order till 2019. This helps us to successfully transform the client base and product portfolio from a traditional era to a new time. Right now, our current sales volume is about a couple of $100 million, but in the future, we're looking towards billion. There's also other changes that we have conducted. For instance, we diversify our service. Besides selling aircraft itself, we're also thinking more about providing better service. Before the M&A, service or maintenance accounted for less than 10% of the sales volume for Cirrus. After we took over, we strengthened these maintenance services provision. In the past, we outsourced the maintenance services. Now we're moving forward. We're hoping to increase the percentage of maintenance to almost 30%. Those were the things that we have done over the past 3 years. Because of those changes, we have seen fruitful results. Of course, we cannot be complacent and maintain that we're successful already. However, we know that we're on the right path, and we have become more and more confident. We have stepped out from the Chinese territory, and we have successfully acquired an American company and acquired new market share. And also, I have a few words to remind you things about market risks. First, legal risk. When we were doing our due diligence, my lawyer friend told me that you are buying aircraft, so you have to pay more attention to product liability insurance. However, my lawyer friend didn't tell me that I have to think about legal risk. America is a country that is fond of lawsuits. No matter how well you do your due diligence, there's always legal risk involved. Even till now, we're still dealing with a lot of legal problems, legal risk. I am sure this is a situation that is faced by many other Chinese enterprises. Also, there are a lot of things that we have to consider. For me, if you don't know much about law, buying intellectual property rights is better than buying equity. Also, another lesson that I have learned is about leadership, the management team. When we come to the States, we fully trust all our American counterparts. But even that, we have to spend enough time to establish trust between us and our American counterparts. And the fourth lesson that I learned is the importance of governance, corporate governance. To run a company well, you have to set the rules straight before you enter the new company. You have to set the game rules so that everybody knows what rules to abide by. This way, you will save time. So these are the lessons that I would like to share with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Wu. If you'd like to join us up at the panel, we're going to begin our 10-minute Q&A session. I'd like to invite the panel chair, Mr. Craig Miller, the speakers, Mr. Brock and Mr. Choi, onto the stage once again.
We're live?
Well, first of all, I would like to thank everyone for their presentations and the Hong Kong Trade Development Council for having us all here and helping us further our understanding of how we can collaborate together and grow the international business. I wanted to take 1 minute to remind everybody that we're looking for questions. They're collecting them along the side. So please, if you have some questions to ask of the speakers, pass them down and they'll be brought up here. I wanted to thank Ms. Luemi for the introduction on the Chinese encouragement about going global. The amount of business that Guangdong has done, just as a quick summary, they're the number one GDP and number one exporter in China. Mr. Yip on the close relationship between Guangdong and Hong Kong and the amazing 39% annual average growth of their FDI. And really what kind of great experience that's provided their professionals in the finance, the due diligence, the advisory, and really trying to create a win-win environment. He mentioned manufacturing as a focus and certainly part of the reason you all might be here because of the Chicago base in that area. Mr. Han also mentioned that and I think expanded that discussion into advanced manufacturing. I think it's important to note as part of this collaboration and how we might work together that Chicago's just recently put in the major U.S. digital manufacturing lab here, and there's a few hundred million dollars of investment in focusing on new technology and new advanced manufacturing that's being developed and just recently opened in the city here. So hopefully those efforts can create another avenue of collaboration. And I really think the question that we're looking at is how do we drive new growth and new investment? Dennis talked about the legal common law base and independence, and Chris, the simple or no tax opportunities there, and then sort of everyone's notes on all the great professionals. I think that was shown by Mr. Wu's success story in the great quality and service improvements, the strategies for growth, and then maybe we start while the questions are being brought up on his note about lawsuits in the U.S. and how there's some differences there. Maybe I can ask each of you to talk about what you see as a major challenge in bringing people together and working in the U.S. and Hong Kong. You all have mics.
I don't think there's any challenge for us to work with foreigners. Mm-hmm. I mean, of course, but the most challenge is, how to convince our Chinese client to follow the game rule. Yeah. I mean, if we are doing the M&A, there's a quite standard procedure and a lot of work to do. But sometimes our Chinese client they don't want to follow the rules or the procedure.
So this is that one of big, in the U.S., challenge. You guys see different procedures here in legal or tax or just overall and in doing deals in the two, in the city, in, I mean, in China versus the U.S.?
I don't, but to answer your question perhaps a different way is there's probably an issue of managing expectations. There's quite often a different approach between Chinese corporations or Chinese entities and Western entities in terms of managing companies and management. In a Chinese corporation, typically the chairman is the most important individual, and the general manager is somebody who manages. In a particularly an English corporation or a Western corporation, the chairman of the board is almost titular, and it's the managing director or the general manager who's most important. And in terms of understanding those different cultural tensions, so that if you don't get it right in your joint venture, you can end up with two characters who both think they run the company, and that can cause frictions and tensions. There's a lack of understanding as to who is the titular head and who is the real decision maker who implements policy.
So it's understanding culture.
Yep.
Yeah, this is very, very good questions. Frankly to say, I still struggling about dealing with people. When you say Hong Kong, I think you mean also China. Actually,
yes.
It's not easy. We put this way. We set up the visions, the common goal from both sides. I mean, this kind of vision can drive people to working together. Of course, we put very good incentive policies for this team, especially for our U.S. leadership team. The third one is important, I think, is put up the communication process. This kind of process can mitigate some of the cultural conflicts, because in a company, we speak the same language, the company language. This kind of process can drive to the success communications for futures. Yeah.
Okay. Maybe before we go back with the panel, we have a question from Mr. Wu. Would you mind addressing that? It is really pleased to discuss the process of how you got past the antitrust authorization. Is he? No?
Henry?
Is this this panel? Are you asking Mr. Wu back? Oh, the panel. Is Mr. Wu here?
Yeah.
Okay, yes. So, how did you get through that?
Sorry, what?
The question is how you, briefly, the process to get past the antitrust authorization.
Yeah, as I said in my presentations, we do need to set up some rules in the first point.
Mm-hmm.
When I say the rules, I mean the process, the policies. Because in a company, within a company, every people, especially for the senior leadership team, need to speak the same language. When I say same language, I'm not saying you speak English or Mandarin.
Right.
You speak the company's languages. I mean, we set up the same cultures. We use the same process to guide the day-to-day operation job.
Yes. Okay, totally change the subject. Do you have advice for property brokers, U.S. real estate investments, Chinese investors through Hong Kong? This is from Jonathan Levi, Fortune International. Any advice on real estate investment? to Chinese buyers and investors through Hong Kong is what the question is. So to market, how would they market U.S. real estate investments to your buyers for foreign, for Chinese investment in U.S. real estate?
Well, typically, international projects are advertised through our press. So we see every week there are in the South China Morning Post, which is the English language newspaper, and I presume in the Chinese press as well, developers from, in particular, the United Kingdom and Singapore advertising developments in London and Singapore to potential investors in Hong Kong. And I presume the same must exist in the Chinese press in China.
So direct advertising is the most efficient way?
Yes.
Yep. So do you have any war stories? What's your greatest war story of an acquisition in the cross-border?
Well, happily I don't have any because I'm a trial lawyer, but it's...
You actually should have more than any of us.
But Chris, you're the advisor.
You mean share more experience? Mm-hmm. Wow, a lot of story. There's a lot of story. Once I represent for my British client to doing a finance due diligence in China, it's quite impressive because the Chinese company there are free audit reports, free financial statement, and free different versions of the report. You know what I mean? Okay. But sometimes it's, you know, because if you really want to work with some partner, you have to transparency. Yeah, and for a Chinese company and for an American company as well. And because that the Chinese company basically is operating quite well, but because they find that there are three different versions of financial statement and audit report. So my British client just broke out. They don't want to work with the Chinese client, the Chinese company anymore, because the trust is
gone.
Yeah.
Well, Mr. Wu, you spoke to trust, and this may be the last question, so if you have others, you can come up afterwards, but maybe you could elaborate a little bit on the trust and the culture change you had to create. You spoke to it briefly, but the question here really was, what process did you go through to help people understand the cultures and gain that trust as you built your company here?
Yeah, I will say that to keep the trust, build the trust, you set up the policies and you insist on the policies year over year over year. Then people understand, okay, this is the new approach. All of us need to comply with these policies and approach like this. Then, as you also have, I mean, very special incentive plan for this guy, you set up the town, you build up the trust. This is the way we do.
So setting goals and then rewarding those goals as you
mentioned
very clearly. Okay. Well, I want to thank each of our panelists here, the other speakers, and all of you for joining us. And I know we're running right up against when the next business meeting starts. So thank you all.
Thank you.